Rowdy Armstrong, I want to talk about that stuff. And it's
what about him?
It's gay professional wrestling, right?
Yes, gay professional wrestling.
Why make that determination, and what makes it different than any other wrestling? Because to me, the objective is still the same. The guy who wins gets to rub his junk on the guy who loses face.
Yeah, I call it gayer professional wrestling. I mean, there's nothing gayer than professional wrestling, and they know it. It's funny because if you look at the independent professional wrestling, those guys know it. They make jokes about it, and they play up to it. But the reason I wrote them is because I wrote another book first called Service, which is a love story of two young men. And it's beautiful. It's a beautiful book. It's kind of corny, and it's just a love story. But I got a lot of gay men read it, and they're like, oh my God, this is the story of my life and all this. But a lot of women read it, which I didn't expect. And every woman was like, this is a beautiful book, but where's the sex? So I was like, what? So that's why I wrote those other books. I wrote a book just for sex, basically. But there's a lot of love. Did you read any of Rowdy Armstrong at all?
Oh, no, not yet. I just found out about it. I mean, I've only known about you for a week or so. I'm fascinated that they made a video game, and I want to get to that.
Well, it's not a video game. It's not a video game. It's an interactive novel. So you're basically the star, but you can become a wrestler, create your own character, and you can wrestle these other people in a novel, basically.
Oh, I get it. I thought it was a video game.
I wish. That'd be great.
I know there's a lot of adult video games out there. I don't get the idea behind that. I mean, I'm not a video game person to begin with, but I don't, at some point, what happened to just regular human sex? Why do you have to put on virtual reality and that kind of stuff? Well,
I mean, come on, nowadays you not only have to put on a condom, now you have to put on a mask and everything. Why not have video game sex?
I guess it is safer. So do you get any have you had any taken any abuse from people in the wrestling world about this stuff?
There was one comment from one guy. I didn't know who he was, but he was some independent pro wrestler, and he wrote something like this is so disrespectful to the sport and all this stuff. And I was like, professional wrestling? It's disrespectful? I mean, like, do you know who Joey Ryan is?
Yeah.
Joey Ryan is hysterical. Joey Ryan has this gimmick where, well, he, guys grab his junk and his penis is so strong it's able to flip them over. So my books are disrespectful to that.
Yeah, right.
A lot of guys think it's hysterical. They think it's funny.
Yeah, I have a friend who's a professional wrestler. He's not a big time professional wrestler yet. He's striving towards that, but he's got a lot of fans, and they're always posting these pictures, and they're talking like they're filled with testosterone, and they're just like these really homophobic rough guys, and they posting all these pictures of these really pretty Adonis looking stuff, and I'm like, man, are you sure you're not gay?
Dude,
you got posters of Adonis is all over your wall. What's the deal with that?
Exactly. If professional wrestling wasn't homoerotic, they could do it clothed. They could do it with their clothes on, and they wouldn't have to, oil up and shave everything. They know, the smart guys know it's homoerotic. They know it is. So who's your friend that's a professional wrestler?
His name is John Caruso. He's not. I forget. Johnny Crash, I think, is his.
Oh, cool! Right on. That's awesome.
It's small time stuff, it's not WWE. Yeah. I had Tommy Lister on a couple of weeks ago, who was he was Zeus who fought Hulk Hogan. And
oh, nice.
I never really knew anything about professional wrestling. I was sweating it out, like, what am I gonna talk to a wrestler about? And we didn't talk about wrestling one time. We just talked about people in Hollywood he knew and worked with the entire time. Talked a little about race relations and stuff like that. But nice. So that Rowdy Armstrong stuff, has gotten a lot of is it successful for you? Is it doing well?
Yeah, it's pretty good. Everybody should check it out. It's funny because I have it's really good. I get a lot of fan mail on it. It's really funny. And it's funny because I get a lot of gay guys are like, oh, this is so hot. Like, I could only get a few pages at a time. But it's funny because I've gotten a bunch of straight guys that say, this is the funniest thing I've ever read. I love this. it's funny. And one guy, my favorite fan letter ever is one guy wrote, "I'm straight and I'm not ashamed to tell you that it got me hard a couple times."
So there you go. So buy the book just for that.
I do want to say too that the thing that surprises people is there's like relationship stuff in there, and there's it's not just can I say the word?
Yeah, you can take whatever you want.
It's not just ass fucking, there's romance too. So it's nice.
Now that should be the tagline of the book.
It's not just ass fucking, it's romance too. Yeah.
So then there's another title of a book that I read it to a friend today, and I almost couldn't say it. Lesbian Slut Gang Bang. Well, it's almost too many visuals in one phrase for a small brain like mine to process. What is the motivation behind writing that book, and what's it all about?
It's a geopolitical parable on the current. No, seriously, it's about. It seriously is. It's about the human condition, and lesbian slut gangbang is a metaphor for the human condition. And I'm not going to get into it too much because it talks about it in the book.
Right.
Why it is, but it's about a guy who encounters people not from this planet, and he has to explain the human condition, and one of the best ways to explain it is lesbian slut gangbang. Right? Am I right?
Well, I'm going to have to read it and get back to you on that.
It's definitely
an interesting idea, and that's where I kind of want to take this next. Where do your ideas come from? What's your creative process like? Like when you sit down, you're just laying in bed one day, and you. Oh, lesbian slut gangbang. Yeah. I mean, how does it come to you? What's your creative process like?
God, that's hard to say because I have woken up before and had a dream. It comes everywhere. I go running a lot, and then I work out on the beach, and I get ideas, and I like, why don't I have paper? My biggest inspiration is what do I want to read? What do I want to see? Because I want all my books to be made into films as well. So it's, what do I want to see? What do I want to read? What do I want to enact with? And I have a lot of, I'm a filmmaker too, and I have a lot of friends who are actors, and it's like, what do I want to see them do? That's my main inspiration.
So I started out talking about cancel culture and how it doesn't seem to affect you. Well, the Robitards. I want to just talk about that. There is a whole faction of people who now, if you use the suffix, I guess, tard on anything, you're being mean to people with mental disabilities and all that kind of stuff. And I think it's just getting a little ridiculous because people, libtard, fucktard, whatever, they throw tard on the end of it. But a whole group of people just gets up in outrage about that. You didn't seem to care about that when you did a Robitard. And I think, it was pretty hysterical when I saw it, but I could see people reacting to that. You're not concerned with that.
It's funny because, I made a Robitards with, I have a podcast of myself called Unimaginary Friendcast, and I make films with my two co-hosts, Aaron and Nathan, and we did a Robitards together. It came from, because you see so many ridiculous exercise videos online, and it's like a cult on its own. So we came up with a Robitards. People aren't going to believe me, but this is true. There are two words I won't say, and the R word is one because I think it's horrible. We came up with the Robitards because we like the gear that we wear is a leotard, and we're doing aerobics. And I swear to God, we didn't even think about it until someone else brought it up because we were like aerobics and leotards. I swear to God.
Yeah, the red suits that you're wearing. Okay.
And then people are like, that's not nice. And we were like, what? And then I was like, oh. But I don't know. We thought about changing it, but we love the sound of it. And I guess we'll just have to keep explaining that we're not saying it because of that.
Well, yeah, I've been called that word my entire life, and it never bothered me. And I have a form of autism. It's a high functioning autism, but it's still that word doesn't bother me. So when people say, you know, and I've always thought of myself as a retard. I really have. I mean, and I don't say that to be mean or anything to anybody who has mental disabilities. But the word used to have a medical definition. And I know I've been emotionally retarded by the things I did to myself in my teenage years, meaning all the substance abuse that I did kind of retarded my emotional development. So I've always been retarded on that level, at least. So I don't have a problem with the word, and I understand that people do, and I try not to use it out of context or use it to insult somebody. But you know, if somebody's using it in a fun kind of thing like that, it wouldn't bother me at all, and it doesn't. I'm going to put the link below in the descriptions of all the versions of this. Thank you. I think people really need to see the video because there's a couple of parts where you will seriously laugh out loud, where you're just like, "Oh my god, that's funny."
Thank you. I have to admit, it's one of my favorite things I've done. I love it. We're shopping that around too, actually, for a show.
Oh really? Yeah. Oh cool.